The intersection of endurance sport, health, fitness and life. Challenging conventional ideas and empowering people with the science of self-propelled motion. This is the Endurance Experience Podcast, hosted by Tony Rich.
What I'm saying in there, there's a whole chapter on just angry people who don't like anything, including science. And one of them, it's a riff. He just says, "I hate that science, and that science has brought some of the worst things that's ever happened to humanity, and pollution, and this." He goes on and on and on and on and on. And so I reply. It's letters from an astrophysicist, and I reply as calmly and as rationally as possible when you get attacked that way. But what I'm saying is, not everyone embraces everything that science does. And some will cherry pick it. You have the science deniers for global warming. You have science deniers with vaccines. You have science deniers with GMOs. You have there's all manner of science denying going on in modern society. And, you know, we in a free society, what are you going to do, right? People can think what they want. But if thinking what they want influences policy, which then affects everybody, then your science denial has consequences to the economic health of the nation. And by the way, it's not only economics, the economic health, it's your physical health, because medicine flows through advances in science, as well as our security.
Well, there's people that deny some aspects of science while conveniently using other. That's where it gets weird, right? You're driving a car that's relying on GPS. You're using a phone to complain about the global warming hoax. You know, you're
correct. One of my more sort of popular tweets was, you remember when we had the photo of the black hole from a distant galaxy, and it was banner headlines, maybe a year ago, less than a year ago, banner headlines, and a first photo ever of a black hole. And it was an astounding engineering achievement to accomplish that. It was multiple telescopes all around the world pooling the data to get it right. And it was one of the greatest collaborative efforts we've ever undertaken in my field of astrophysics. Okay. And everybody was loving the results. So all I tweeted was, "Scientist, we produced the first ever image of a supermassive black hole 55 million light years away." The response, "Ooh." "Scientist, we've concluded that humans are catastrophically warming the Earth." Response, "That conflicts with what I want to be true, so it must be false."
Well,
that is the cherry picking of science.
It is the cherry picking of science. But the global warming thing is very much connected to a certain type of ideology. A certain type of person who thinks of themselves
it doesn't matter
as a
to me.
No nonsense person.
What I'm saying, right? Yes, it does matter. What I'm trying to say is that is a demographic that has cherry picked science to deny human caused global warming. There are other demographics that have cherry-picked other science to deny other things. And it's not all located in one political spectrum. I mean, one political branch.
Right.
So you tend to find liberal folk complaining that the conservatives who have embraced no global warming platform are denying science, and they need science on their side. And many of those same people are rubbing crystals together to be healed by the crystal energy, or they're denying vaccines, thinking that they're somehow bad for you. And so all of this requires some or total rejection of mainstream science. And we're living in that world now, and I don't know – I don't think it'll stop the progress of civilization, but it can certainly slow it down and occasionally stall it.
That was a clip from a podcast with Neil deGrasse Tyson and Joe Rogan on Joe Rogan's podcast, The Joe Rogan Experience. I believe it was the end of 2019. But I wanted to play it, that short clip, because it's the subject of this brief podcast and retrospective of 2020. Before that, I want to wish you a happy new year. And this is the time where people make New Year's resolutions. As someone who made a career out of training and coaching athletes, I generally advise not to make New Year's resolutions, or maybe not get in the habit of making New Year's resolutions, whether it be for athletic or fitness pursuits or otherwise. And that's because if you want to make positive changes in your life in any way, you should really be in a constant state of doing that all of the time. There's nothing at all particular about the planet making another trip around the sun that says you have to start doing something at the end of that trip around the sun. Take action anytime and all of the time when you feel you want to make a change to your life or decide that you want to change your fitness or athletic pursuits or anything. Make positive changes all of the time. For the same exact reason, I found it absolutely unbearable every time, whether it be on social media or on television, someone proclaimed that they couldn't wait for 2020 to be over. My goodness, heesh, people. Again, there's nothing particular about a year, right? So things happen unexpectedly. People die unexpectedly. Bad things happen. Good things happen. And case in point, it's 2021. There have been some good things that have happened. And absolutely, there have also been some bad things that have happened. With that being said, what happened on January 6th in Washington, D.C., was a pretty deplorable display for humanity. Obviously, I'm referring to the incitement of a riot and civil war-like behavior that we haven't seen in hundreds of years. It got me thinking about how such events begin to brew. And the same topic of science denial, how they're related. Because I realized that there are some commonalities in the origin of such behaviors. I'm talking about tribalism run rampant, how the environment is ripe for the trafficking in groupthink and echo chambers, radicalization fueled by confirmation bias and conspiracy theory thinking, just to name a few off the top of my head. And all of this sums up what we saw in our last trip around the sun. The issue of science denial is not just something that's ripe in health, nutrition, and fitness, but it's bigger than that. You heard the sentiments of Neil deGrasse Tyson in that early clip. I am actually convinced that science denial is probably the biggest existential threat humanity faces. Let's consider the anti-vaccination phenomena. First off, we saw a pretty impressive display from science and medicine this year with vaccination, considering this time last year, we were only just hearing about the coronavirus and getting worried. Think about that. Now we verifiably have tested vaccines, multiple options going into people's arms right now. Think about that. 1 year time. Think about where you were last year, this time, and when you started to hear about this coronavirus stuff. And now we have vaccinations going into people's arms. Incredible. But if you saw the Pew Research results as of the end of last year, the percentages of people who say they won't get the vaccine, are still extremely high. It leaves one shaking their head. People saying they probably or definitely won't get the vaccine is somewhere near 40% as of the end of last year. Now, that number is down from the fall, suggesting it may continue to fall. We'll see. But that's still very high, considering we need to get at least 70% of the populace vaccinated for solid herd immunity. And when you drill down into the people who say they won't get the vaccine, less than half of those people say they could change their mind. I'll put the link to the data in the show notes. By the way, it cuts by age in such a way that is probably not surprising. You're more likely to get the vaccine the younger you are. By sex, you're more likely to get the vaccine if you're male by a double-digit margin for some reason. And my community, the Black community, is the least likely ethnic group to say they will either definitely or probably get the vaccine. The only ethnic group under 50%. You're also more likely to get the vaccine the more you lean to the left on the political spectrum, and the less likely the more you lean to the right. That's not surprising given what we witnessed in 2020 with the battle between mask wearers and non-mask wearers. Let's see, you're more likely to get the vaccine the more wealthy you are, and you're more likely to get the vaccine the smarter you are. That is, the more education you have. It's a pretty clear relationship from the graph. So that's how some of the data shakes out. Again, I highly recommend you go check out the link in the show notes. So what is the reason for all of this? Some of which you can discern in the data. But if you glanced at your social media presence, you've seen a level of conspiracy theory thinking that was seemingly barking mad. I mean, people saying that Bill Gates was trying to secretly implant some form of nanotechnology in people for tracking purposes, and other such nonsense. Other people have pointed at instances where science has failed in the past. If you remember my podcast with Dr. Corey A. Baer in season 3, he talked about the Tuskegee experiment, which was a genuine example of a failure.
The Tuskegee study of untreated syphilis in the male Negro. The program began in the 1920s to document the devastating impact of syphilis. Syphilis was a dreaded disease. Symptoms included severe skin rashes, fever, and pain. To find out more about how the disease affects the body, the Public Health Service initiated a program in Macon County, Alabama, a rural farming community with a high incidence of syphilis. 600 men were recruited for the study. 400 had syphilis. 200 used as a control did not. Nearly all were poor farmers or sharecroppers. Initially, the men in the study received treatments, but with the stock market crash, funds were no longer available and treatments were terminated. However, researchers continue to collect data on the men in the expectation that funding for treatment would become available within 6 months. Ultimately, the 6 months of non-treatment would continue for 40 years, and throughout that period, the men were never told the whole truth.
Events in history like the Tuskegee experiment were problematic. But in many of these such cases, these are examples where they became failures of humans versus failures of the scientific method. Also, if you're going to use the Tuskegee experiment as the reason to not get a vaccine, well, then just about every human on the planet could refuse a vaccine based upon that logic. Because when you look back in history, there were several other egregious errors that one can point to. There was the experiments on Australian Aboriginals by Adelaide University researchers in the 1920s and 1930s. There were syphilis experiments in the 1940s on tens of thousands of Guatemalans, many of them prisoners. And that was because it was once thought that prisoners were cheaper than chimpanzees. There was the infamous Project 4.1 by the U.S. military, where subjects in the Marshall Islands in 1954 were tested without knowledge to discern the effects of nuclear war. There was a military-sponsored hepatitis experiment on some disabled children in the 1950s and 1960s, which was administered by the Willowbrook State Hospital in New York. And then there was the well-documented experiments preceding the Second World War in Germany on Jewish people and other ethnicities. There was the genetic experiments conducted on the Havasupai tribe in 1989 by researchers in ASU, and that's just one of many that were conducted on Native Americans. There was the Unit 731, which was conducted during World War II on Japanese and other people of Asian descent, which were experiments on POWs and civilians. And then there was the placebo HIV drug experiments in the 1990s, which had impacted tens of thousands of African women. So those are just a few that you can go out on Google and learn about. There are many, many other examples, too many to even discuss. And yes, Africans and African Americans, Native Americans were certainly often on the receiving end of such erroneous displays of our medical and scientific infancy. But again, just about every population can point to some appalling example. No one ethnic group can claim a universal right to be infringed and use that as grounds to deny vaccination or be skeptical of medicine today. So it's reasonable to state anyone's concern over what happened in the past is warranted. I will submit that. But to just decree by fiat that this is the reason why one is justified at denying science, in my opinion, there is a serious flaw in this line of reasoning. Suppose I said to you that I qualified for the Ironman World Championship in Hawaii, but I wasn't going to go. And you ask me, why, Tony, aren't you going? And I say, look, I'm not getting on any airplanes. Remember that event, September the 11th, 2001? That's the reason I'm not getting on an airplane ever. I would expect for you to look at my statement with a very raised eyebrow. Of course, the very fact that that happened almost 20 years ago now, the probability of such an event happening on the plane today has greatly diminished because people have recognized the errors that were made and have created fixes for those errors. And whatever the probability is, it certainly doesn't register enough to deter people from getting on planes. That's not an example that maps perfectly one-to-one, but it's a consciousness-raising exercise for anyone who would wish to base decisions on events that have happened decades ago. Whenever bad things happen in science or medicine in history, the remedy has always been simply more science, better science. And so today we have the most robust clinical trial process, peer review, double-blind, randomized, placebo-controlled trials, built-in mechanisms to remove bias, tons of oversight, checks and balances. And so debunked and unethical ideas die, and what remains is the very best and high-quality approaches based on the very best cumulative empirical evidence. This is paraphrased by a statement popularized by the scientist Max Planck, known as Planck's principle. It stated, quote, "Science progresses one funeral at a time," end quote. I mean, doesn't that make sense? We seem to take for granted that we don't have to worry about polio, smallpox, diphtheria, or any of the other diseases that have been eradicated by vaccines over the past decades. And so, I am not a physician, and I'm certainly not the one to give you medical advice, but I can tell you that I always get vaccinated, and as such, I will also be getting the COVID-19 vaccinations as soon as possible, and that will be the best decision for me to protect myself from COVID-19. I echo the sentiment of Neil deGrasse Tyson in his podcast with Joe Rogan that I played in the opening clip. Do you find it all peculiar that people who would sidestep science for the most esoteric conspiracy theory, but some of the same exact people will take up energy healing, astrology, and other such primitive superstition? Look, at any given point in time during 2020, someone could have proved us all wrong and stepped forward with their cure for COVID-19 with their essential oils, their homeopathic remedy, or by stabbing so-called chi meridians with needles, or their reiki or cure-all superfood or naturopathic remedy. Where were their extraordinary claims? There was a Nobel Prize in medicine just waiting for them. Where were they last year? Nowhere. The reason why should be obvious. During this global pandemic, this real-time stress test of what works and what doesn't, first-line medical workers, science, and vaccination, they are all examples demonstrating how the scientific method is the best tool ever devised to benefit humanity. So we should all appreciate this, and for those who need to, recalibrate your GPS and remember this. And for those that are seeing all of this play out in real time, yet you're still unconvinced of the merits of science and denying science, well, then I don't know what to say to you. Believe what you must, do what you must. But while you're doing so, make sure you turn in your iPhone. Now, I have to touch on a phenomena I've witnessed far too often recently, this sort of selective accepting of science, where someone will accept science when it's convenient to accept it, but then relax it when it's convenient to relax it. That is to say that they will accept it insofar as the science agrees with a cherished view of the world. But when it doesn't agree with a cherished view of the world, they will pretend like it doesn't exist. So this was pointed out in the clip at the beginning of the podcast. It sometimes doesn't matter what one's political leanings are. I've seen it come from people who would self-describe as being on the right, people who would self-describe as being on the left. And this podcast would be hours going through all of the examples. But know that I've seen it play out with people on both sides of the spectrum that would claim to accept science. But as soon as the preponderance of the empirical evidence challenges a viewpoint that may have been canonized within a certain preferable in-group, then right before your very eyes, the person will transform into a science denier and use the same exact playbook as, say, a climate change denier. And right out of that playbook, the process of obfuscation begins. That is to deliberately make things unclear, be evasive, decree that the science is being fabricated by thousands of scientists colluding with each other, either for nefarious reasons or for profit. Look, science done correctly and evaluated correctly, it shouldn't matter at all what your politics are. It shouldn't matter what your chosen in-group wants to believe or has canonized that you should believe. You evaluate the facts, evaluate the empirical evidence, and call balls and strikes wherever they land. All you need to do is take a look at the polarization that occurred in 2020 across the planet. The mob that stormed the Capitol building in the United States is a perfect example of what happens when people fail to think independently and do nothing but get so wound up after being trafficked within groupthink circles and echo chambers. There seems to be less appetite from people to consider varying points of views or being open to having evaluative, emotionally detached, and objective discussion and conversation. And what people are doing is essentially saying, you can't agree 95% with me. You need to agree 100% with me. Because if you only agree 95% with me, I'm going to cancel you for the 5% that you happen to disagree with me slightly. And that's really not a tenable way to relate with each other. So to finish up the podcast, I feel a duty to leave you with something helpful considering all that we've experienced in 2020 and what we may experience this year. I'm going to leave you with the same rubric that I use, which has been helpful to me, not only as an athlete, a coach that trains athletes, and also someone that's trained in data science and that has used this rubric to evaluate research. My aim here is that you use these rules, which are essentially three simple rules that make up this rubric, as a means to assist you in navigating the environment and just about every concept you might come across in health, fitness, sports, and in life. And ideally, I'd be happy if it helped just one person become a more effective and evaluative thinker, avoid bad information or bad ideas, and stay above the toxic environment of polarization, and radicalization. Number one, always have an empirical approach to deciding what is true. Now, the scientific method is the best tool ever devised by humanity to do this because we've proven that it works. And this avoids arguments from authority, arguments from personal experience, and helps you discern the difference between what's true and what you might want to be true, which are two entirely different things. Unfortunately, there are a great many people in today's toxic environment that confuse the two. When the empirical foundations are conclusive, there's consensus, and it's all pointing in a specific direction, you accept the results, regardless of your political leanings or what your in-group has canonized as beliefs and positions. Anyone can make a claim or an extraordinary claim, but as the scientist Carl Sagan popularized, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. Number two, be skeptical of everything that lacks strong evidence. That includes being aware of your own biases, because none of us are immune to confirmation bias. None of us. Even me. It's incredibly important to meticulously interrogate your own beliefs so as to mitigate succumbing to confirmation bias. If you find a belief might be particularly self-serving, that's the time to reach down even deeper for added skepticism. Okay, this helps ensure you don't get too confused and too drawn in with groupthink or other echo chamber-like hysteria. It's probably good practice to avoid erecting and existing in echo chambers altogether for obvious reasons. And this is the reason why we see mob-like behavior of the sort that you saw in Washington, D.C. on January 6th. Number three, periodically evaluate concepts that challenge your own worldview or conclusions. So whether it's evaluate counter-research, a rival's positions, books, etc. This one is particularly difficult because if you've ever had to sit through something that you knew or you thought was bad information or you were critical of or was counter to your own conclusions, it's very difficult to do. But it's going to require that you take an emotionally detached and objective posture. This is a critical fail-safe to ensure you still have accurate conviction for your own positions. And this way, you're also able to, quote-unquote, steel man your opponent's best arguments and understand the most salient counter-arguments insofar as they may exist. And more importantly, after evaluating the information and you find out that you are wrong, well, that's when you change your mind and accept the new position. There you have it. That is the rubric that I've used. I hope it helps you as it has helped me. It allows you to have focus and stand with conviction that you based your positions and your understanding on facts and on reality and not on someone else's motivations or their in-group beliefs or conspiracy theory. So, I hope everyone has a happy new year. Things seem to be pointing in the right direction. But certainly, we're sure to see many unpredicted moments. So, position yourself to be prepared for anything and to thrive under any environment in this next trip around the sun. This is effectively the last episode of season 3. After this will be the best of episode, where I look back at 5 of the most downloaded and listened to episodes in season 3. Which ones will they be? You'll have to see. Then there will be a short break as I prepare for season 4 of the Endurance Experience. Happy New Year, everyone.
Follow Event Horizon Endurance Sport on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter for training programs and services to become a member of our Endurance Institute, or for a complete archive of podcasts, log on to our website, eventhorizon.tv.